This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Boycotted and Other Stories by Talbot Baines Reed. Story 1. Chapter 1, The School Cuts Me. I hardly know yet what it was all about, and at the time I had not an idea. I don't think I was more of a fool than most fellows of my age at Draven's, and I rather hope I wasn't an out-and-out cad. But when it all happened, I had my doubts on both points, and could explain the affair in no other way than by supposing I must be like the lunatic in the asylum, who, when asked how he came to be there, said, "I said the world was mad, the world said I was mad, the world was bigger than I was, so it shut me up here." It had been a dismal enough term, as it was, quite apart from my troubles. That affair of Brown had upset us all, and taken the spirit out of Draven's. We missed him at every turn. What was the good of getting up the football 15 when our only place kick was gone? Where was the fun in the Saturday nights when our only comic singer, our only reciter, our only orator wasn't there? Who cared about giving study suppers or any other sociable entertainment when there was no Brown to invite? Brown had left us suddenly. One day he had been the life and soul of Draven's. Next morning he had been summoned to Draven's study, and that same evening we saw him drive off to the station in a cab with his portmanteau on the top. Very few of the fellows knew why he had been expelled. I scarcely knew myself, though I was his greatest chum. On the morning of the day he left, he met me on his way back from Draven's study. "I'm expelled, Smither," he said with a dismal face. "Go on," replied I, taking his arm and scrutinizing his face to see where the joke was hidden. But it was no joke. "I am," said he hopelessly. "I am to go this evening. It's my own fault. I've been a cad. I was led into it. It's bad enough, but I'm not such a blackleg as Draven makes out." And here for the first time in my life, I saw Brown look like breaking down. He wasn't going to let me see it, and hurried away before I could find anything to say. If he hadn't told me himself, I should have called anyone who told me Brown had been a cad. Well, I'd better not say what I should have called him. I knew my chum had been a rollicking sort of fellow, who found it hard to say no to anybody who asked anything of him, but that he was a blackleg I, for one, would not believe, for all the Dravens in the world. Hardly knowing what I did, I walked up to the master's study door and knocked. "Come in." I could tell by the voice that came through the door I should do no good. I went in. Mr. Draven was pacing up and down the room, and stopped short in front of me as I entered. "Well?" I wished I was on the other side of the door, but I wasn't, and must say something, however desperate. "Please, Sir Brown." "Brown leaves here today," said Mr. Draven coldly. "What do you want?" "Please, sir, I hope you will." I forgot where I was and what I was saying. My mind wandered aimlessly, and I ended my sentence I don't know how. Draven saw I was confused, and wasn't unkind. "You have been a friend of Brown, I know," he said, "and you are sorry." "So am I, terribly sorry," and his voice quite quavered as he spoke. There was a pause, and I made a frantic effort to recall my scattered thoughts. "Won't you let him off this time, sir?" I gasped. "That, Smither, is out of the question," said the headmaster so steadily and incisively that I gave it up and left the room without another word. The fellows were trooping down the passage to breakfast, little guessing the secret of my miserable looks or the reason why Brown was not in his usual place. But the secret came out, and the school staggered under the shock. Mr. Draven announced our comrade's departure kindly enough in the afternoon, adding that he had confessed the offense for which he was expelled, and was penitent. 2 hours later we saw his cab drive off, and as we watched it disappear, it all seemed to us like a hideous dream. We said little about it, to one another. We did not even care to inquire particularly into the offense for which he had suffered. But we moped and missed him at every turn, and wished the miserable term were ending instead of beginning. This, however, is a long digression. I sat down to write the story of my own trouble, not Brown's. But the reader will understand now why I said that, as it was, apart from my own misfortunes, the term, which had still a month more to run when my story begins, had been a dismal one. I was wandering about the playground one frosty November morning, beginning to hope that if a frost should come, we might after all get a little fun at Draven's before the holidays came, when Odger Jr., whistling shrilly, crossed my path. Odger Jr. was not exactly my fag, for we had no fags at Draven's, and if we had had, I had not yet reached that pitch of dignity at which one fellow has the right to demand the services of another. Still, Odger Jr. had, for a consideration, done a good many odd jobs for me, and I had got into the way of regarding him as a quasi-fag. "Hello, youngster," said I as we met, "there's going to be a stunning frost. Can't you smell it in the air? I wish you'd cut down to bangles and get me a pair of straps for my skates." To my astonishment, not wholly unmixed with amusement, Odger Jr. regarded me majestically for a moment, and then, ejaculating the oracular phrase, "Oh, ah," walked off, his 4 foot one drawn to its full height, his hands behind his back, and his mouth still drawn up for whistling, but apparently too overcome with dignity to emit the music which an observer would naturally be led to expect. I was not, on the whole, a short-tempered youth. My laziness saved me from that. It certainly did occur to me, on this bright frosty morning, that it would be exhilarating both for young Odger and me if I were to go after him and kick him. But what was the use? He would enjoy it as much as I should. There would be plenty of ways in which to pay him out less fatiguing than an undignified chase round the playground. So I let him go, and grinned to think how much nicer monkeys are when they behave like monkeys and not like men. I had a lot of work to do in my study that morning before afternoon school, and so had very little time to think of Odger Jr. or anyone else. As it was, I was only just in time to take my usual place in the Greek class when Mr. Draven sailed into the room and the lesson began. I had been so flurried by my hasty arrival that I did not at first observe that the desk on my right, usually occupied by a boy called Potter, was vacant. "Where's Potter?" I asked of my neighbor on the left. "Is he? Why, there he is at Brown's old desk," I added, catching sight of the deserter across the room. Brown's desk had always been left empty since its late owner went. None of us had cared to appropriate it, and the sight of it day after day had fed our sorrow over his loss. It seemed to me, therefore, an act almost of disloyalty on Potter's part towards the memory of my old chum to install himself coolly at his desk without saying a word to anybody. "What's he gone there for?" I inquired of Sadgrove on my left. "He's got no—" "Don't talk to me," said Sadgrove. Sadgrove was in a temper, and I wasn't surprised. So was I, lazy as I was. We had all stuck to Brown through the term, and it was a little too much now to find a fellow like Potter, who professed to be Brown's friend too, stepping in this cold-blooded way into his place. Sadgrove was put up to construe, so there was no opportunity for further conversation had we desired it. I wasn't surprised that Potter avoided me in the playground after school. He guessed, I supposed, what I had to say to him, and had the decency to be ashamed of himself. However, I was determined to have it out, and that evening, after preparation, went up to his study. He was there, and looked guilty enough when he saw me. "Look here, Potter," I began, trying to be friendly in spite of all. I got no further, for Potter, without a word, walked out of the door, leaving me standing alone in the middle of his study. I had seen the working of a guilty conscience once or twice before at Draven's, but never knew it to work in quite so strange a manner as it did with Potter that evening. There was nothing for it but to give him up as a bad job and go to bed, which I did, and awoke next morning in a forgiving mood. It was always a scramble at breakfast on Saturdays at Draven's to see who could get nearest to the ham, for we sickened of the cold mutton they gave us on other days. This morning, to my gratification, I was well up. That is, there were only two fellows before me, so that at any rate I was good for a fair, straight slice from the middle. "Huzzah," said I, crowding up to Williams, who was next above me. "I've never had anything but knuckle all this." Williams faced round as he heard my voice, and then, without waiting to hear the end of my sentence, got up and took a seat at the lower end of the table. "Poor beggar's out of sorts," said I to myself. "Another of his bilious attacks, I suppose," I added, moving up to his seat and addressing the proud occupant of the carver's chair. This fellow was Harrison, whom, next to Brown, we counted the oiliest fellow at Draven's. He could sing and make puns, and though a long way behind Brown, was a popular, jovial companion. He appeared not to hear my remark, but, hitching his chair a little away, began deliberately to carve a slice of ham. He took a long time about it, and I watched him patiently till he was done. It was a prime ham, I could see, and, ashamed as I am to confess it, it made me feel amiable to all the world to find it was so. "If they were all like this," I began. "There's room here, Harrison, old man," Williams called up the table. Whereupon Harrison, plate in hand, went down to keep Williams company, leaving me for the first time in my life top hammer. Somehow, I did not enjoy the dignity quite as much as I should have expected. I was sorry Harrison had gone, for I wanted to speak to him about Potter, and I could not help fancying, from his unusual manner, that he was put out about something, and I thought he might have told me about it instead of chumming up to Williams. However, I was hungry, and took my slice of ham and passed the dish along to the fellow next me, who sat below the two empty chairs up which I had risen. It was rather a solitary meal, and I was glad when it was over and the bell rang for first school. There at least I should have the society of the sympathetic Sadgrove, who, as I knew, felt as sore as I did about Potter's behavior. But to my mortification, as well as perplexity, Sadgrove, I found, had cleared out his desk and removed his goods and chattels to a seat on the row behind mine, where he appeared to have met with a cordial welcome from his new neighbors. I could not make it out. He always told me he liked his desk better than any, and would not change it even for Brown's. And here he was, for no apparent reason, on a lower form at a smaller desk, and in, well, less select society. As I sat in my place that morning, with an empty desk on each side of me, it began slowly to dawn on my mind that something was wrong somewhere. The proceedings of Odger Jr., Potter, Sadgrove, Williams, and Harrison, taken singly, were not of much importance, but taken as a whole, I did not like them. I might be wrong. There might be no intention to cut me, and I could not think of anything I had done or said which would account for it. I would try, at any rate, to get to the bottom of it before I was many hours older. So I went in search of my cousin, who was a few months my senior, and a particular chum of Williams. "I say, Arthur, what did Williams cut me dead for this morning?" Arthur looked uncomfortable and said, "How should I know?" "You do know," said I, "and I want to know why." He colored up and made as though he would leave room. But my blood was up, and I stepped across door. "Tell me this," I said. "Have these fellows cut on purpose or no? However should. You do know. Are they cutting me or no?" He flushed up again, and then said hurriedly, "Yes, we are." Chapter 2. I am beaten. Yes, we are. The reader may think it strange when I tell him that my first sensation on receiving this momentous announcement was one of almost amusement. I knew it was a mistake, and that I had done nothing to merit the sentence which had been passed upon me. Dravens had put itself in the wrong, and I had pride enough to determine that I, of all people, was not going out of my way to put it right. So I took my cousin's announcement coolly, and refrained from demanding any further explanations. "Oh," I said with something like a sneer, and walked off, leaving him, so I flattered myself, rather snubbed. I was boycotted. There was something a trifle flattering in the situation. Brave men before my time had been boycotted. I had read their stories and sympathized with them, and hated, as I hate still, the miscreants who, in the name of patriotism, had acted the sneak's and coward's part to ruin them. Now I was going to taste something of their hardships at the hands of my patriotic schoolfellows, and my spirit rose as I resolved to hold up my head with the bravest of them. Forewarned is forearmed, and when I went into school that afternoon, I gave no one a chance of avoiding me. I spread myself out as comfortably as possible at my place, and shifted some of the papers and books which crowded my own desk into the vacant desks on either side of me, first ejecting rather ostentatiously a few papers and notebooks which had been left in them by their late owners. I was conscious of one or two glances directed my way across the room, but these only added to my pleasure, as I emptied Sadgrove's inkpot into my own, and proceeded cheerfully to cut my initials on Williams's desk. When I was put up to construe, I managed to get through my passage without any sign of trepidation, and when at last the class was dismissed, I took the wind out of the sails of my boycotters by remaining some minutes later than anyone else, completing the decoration of my new quarters. It was easy enough in the playground that afternoon to keep clear of my fellow human beings, and I had, as I persuaded myself, a jolly hour in the gymnasium all by myself. Fellows looked in at the door now and then, but did not disturb my peace, and it was rather gratifying than otherwise to feel that as long as I chose to occupy the place, everyone else would have to wait outside. After all, thought I, as I went to bed that night, boycotting isn't as bad as people make it out. I've had all I wanted today. No one has annoyed me or injured me. I can do pretty much as I like. In fact, I do more than I ever used to be able to do. If anyone is loser by it all, it's the other fellows and not me. I rather enjoy it. Still, I could not help reflecting, as I turned over and went to sleep, I think Harrison might have stuck by me. When I woke next morning, it was with a sense of something on my mind. I tried hard to persuade myself it was amusement, and went down to breakfast, wondering how Dravens would keep it up. I found myself top hammer again, or I should say top muttoner, for ham was a luxury reserved only for one day in the week, and the two chairs below me were again vacant. I helped myself to a slice from the uninviting joint, and then artlessly pushed the dish along one place, opposite the first of the empty chairs, and proceeded to regale myself. It was interesting to see the perplexity which my simple maneuver caused. The next fellow below me, out of reach three chairs away, had nothing for it but either to speak to me, which I calculated his vows would not allow him to do, or else ignominiously to walk up to the seat next mine and possess himself of the dish. He did the latter, and I scored one, the only one I scored for some time to come. For Dravens, seeing I was defiant, felt hurt in its pride, and drew the blockade closer around me. It had expected at least that I should make some effort to win my way back into popularity, and it did not at all like, when it chose to boycott me, that I should boycott it. So gradually, we forgot what the quarrel was about, and set ourselves to see who could hold out longest. A manly, sensible, Christian occupation for 50 fellow creatures during a dull winter month. I never got the gymnasium to myself now, for whenever I went, it was always full, and remained full till I was tired of waiting for a vacant bar or swing. As for football, hockey, paper chasing, and the other school sports, I was of course excluded both by my own pride and the action of the school. In fact, Dravens never pulled together so well at anything as they did at boycotting me during those few weeks. Their discipline was splendid. They all seemed to know exactly what to do and what not to do when I appeared on the scene, and any hopes I had of winning over a few stragglers to my side vanished before the blockade had lasted a week. At first, I didn't mind it. My mettle was up, I was excited, and the consciousness that I was unjustly treated carried me through. But in a few days the novelty began to wear off, and I began to get tired of my own company. I still made the most of my elbow room in class and at meals, but it ceased to be amusing. I tried to work hard in my study every evening, and to persuade myself I was glad of the opportunity of making up for lost time, but somehow or other the distant sounds of revelry and laughter made Livy and Euclid more dull and uninteresting than ever. I tried to hug myself with the notion of how independent I was in school and out, how free I was from bores, how jolly the long afternoon walks were with no one hanging on at my heels, how dignified it was to hold up my head when all the world was against me. But spite of it all, I moped. Greatly to my disgust, Dravens did not mope. As I sat down in my study, or wandered, still more solitary in the crowded playground, it seemed as if all the school except myself had never been in better spirits. Fellows seemed to have shaken off the cloud which Brown's expulsion had left behind. The football team was better than it had been for a year or two, and I overheard fellows saying that the Saturday nights were jollier even than last winter. In fact, it seemed as if, like Jonah, the throwing of me overboard had brought fine weather all round. Still, I was not going to give in. Dravens should be ashamed of itself before I met it halfway. So I watched with satisfaction my face growing pale day by day, and I aided this new departure in my favor by eating less than usual, giving up outdoor exercise, and staying up late over my lessons. I calculated that at the rate I was going, I should be reduced to skin and bones by the end of my term, and perhaps at my funeral Dravens would own they had wronged me. At present, however, my pallor seemed to escape their observation, and as for my late hours, all the good they did me was an imposition from Mr. Draven for breaking rules. As the days went on, I seemed to have dropped altogether out of life. I might have been invisible, for anything anyone seemed to see of me. Even the masters appeared to have joined in the conspiracy to ignore me, and for a whole week I sat at my solitary desk without hearing the sound of my own voice. My readers may scoff when I tell them that at the end of a fortnight I felt like running away. The silence and isolation which had amused me at first became a slow torture at last, and poor-spirited wretch that I was, my only comfort was in now and then crying in bed in the dark. I made up for this secret weakness by putting on a swagger in public, and rendered myself ridiculous in consequence. Dravens could hardly help being amused by a fellow who one day slunk in and out among them self-consciously pale, black under the eyes, with a hacking cough and a funereal countenance, and the next blustered about defiantly and glared at everyone he met. The fact was, having despaired of making a friend, my one longing now was to make an enemy. I would have paid all my pocket money twice over for a quarrel or a fight with somebody. But that was a luxury harder to get even than a friendly word. I tried one day. I was mooning disconsolately round the playground when I met young Wigram, the most artless youngster in all Dravens. "You played up well in the second 15 on Saturday," I said, as if I had spoken to him not 5 minutes ago, whereas, as a matter of fact, the sound of my own voice gave me quite a shock. "Yes," began he, falling into the snare, "I was lucky with that run up from, or I beg pardon, goodbye," and he bolted precipitately. It was a mild victory as far as it went, but it did not end there, for that afternoon I came upon a group in the playground, the central figure of which was the wretched Wigram, on his knees in the act of apologizing humbly all round for having been cad enough to speak to me. It seemed a good chance for the long-wished-for quarrel, and I jumped at it. "Let him go," shouted I, breaking into the group and addressing the company generally. "If anyone touches him, he will have to fight me." Alas, they stared a little, and then laughed a little, and then strolled away with Wigram among them, leaving me alone. After that, I knew I was beaten, and might as well own it, for a disappointed enemy is a far worse failure than a disappointed friend. Still, I clung on to my pride. Broken down as I was, and unnerved and damaged in my self-respect, there was but a week more of the term to run, and I would try to hold out till the end. If I could only do that, I was safe, for I would get my father to take me away at Christmas for good. No, would I? That would be the biggest surrender of all. I could not think what I would do. So I sat down and wrote to Brown for lack of any better occupation, and told him how I envied him his expulsion, and wished any such luck could happen to me. Then I grimly set myself to endure the remaining days of my slow torture. Oh, the silence of those days! The noise and laughter of the fellows was nothing to it. I could endure the one, and in my extremity was even glad of it. But the sealed lips of everyone that met me were like so many daggers. At last I was really ill, or at any rate I was so reduced that unless relief came soon I must either capitulate or run away. Even yet, I found it hard to contemplate the former alternative. I met Harrison one morning in the passage. I suppose I must have looked specially miserable, for contrary to his usual practice now, instead of looking away, he slackened speed as he came up and looked at me. Now was my time surely. I was famished for want of a friendly word or look, and my pride was at its last gasp. I believe I had actually begun to speak, when a sound in the passage startled us both, and we passed by as of old, strangers. I rushed off to my study, ashamed and disappointed, and paced round it like a caged animal. What could I do? Should I write to some of the fellows? Should I tell Draven, or should I escape? Then it occurred to me, had not I a right to know why I was being treated like this? What had I done? Was I a sneak, or a leper, or a murderer, that I should thus be excommunicated and tortured? What a fool I had been not to think of this before. Alas, it was too late now. My pride had made it impossible for me to speak the first word without surrendering all along the line, and even yet, at the 11th hour, I could not face that. So I shut myself up for another day, miserable, nervous, and ill, and counted the minutes to bedtime. The evening post brought a letter from Brown, and thankful for any diversion, and the silent company even of a friendly piece of paper, I crawled off early to my study to make the most of my little comfort. I started, before I had read two lines, and uttered an exclamation of amazement. "Dear Smither, there's been a most frightful mistake. By the same post as brought your letter, I got enclosed from Williams. What a set of cads they've been, and all my fault. I've written to Williams that if it's not all put right in 24 hours, I'll come down, disgraced as I am, and tell Draven. I'm in too great a rage to write more. Unless I get a telegram all right, by 10 tomorrow morning I'll come. Yours ever, P. Brown." Williams's letter enclosed, or rather part of it, for Brown had kept one sheet, was as follows, though my head was swimming so much at the time that I could scarcely take it all in. "The fellows here haven't forgotten you, and they're showing it in a pretty decided way at present. About 3 weeks ago, we discovered that Smither, who called himself your friend, was the sneak who went to Draven.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.